Pennsylvania. Good to be alive in Jesus, amen. Praise God from whom all blessings
thank you. Thank you.
Sings my soul. Well, there is a difference. He makes me glad. That's the difference. I don't have to make myself glad. This ain't religion, y'all. Religion had never done anybody any good. There's been religion forever, man. The Egyptians had funny. You know that there is as much idolatry now as there was in the days of Jesus. You ever read the Bible? In the old days, Baal and all those weird gods, Goomba and all those people, man. People were literally sacrificing their children to these pieces of rock and wood and stuff like that. And man, it's still going on. There are places in the world where people are still sacrificing human lives. It's hard to believe. There's places going on in the world right now. Today, there is war going on in 52 different countries around the world. There are people shooting at each other right now, blowing up bombs, man, terrorism, killing innocent women and children. There were 4.5 million child murders in America last year. They call it abortion, but it's murder. Can everybody hear us tonight? We've been turning it down a little bit lately. Is it loud enough? Yeah. Can you hear the words? Can you understand the words? Can you feel it? You ought to be able to feel it too. Good. So sings my soul. He heard you the first time. So sings my soul and lifts my voice. He makes me glad. I choose to rejoice. I don't have to. That's good, isn't it? Stop and think about it. If you're born again and you ask God, you trust Him. And if you trust God, you'll also ask Him to fill you up with His Word and His love and His Spirit. You won't be afraid of anything He's going to do. God, you don't have to be afraid of God. It says to fear God that is translated as be in awe of because He is holy. Not like, oh, I wonder what He's going to do to me now. God's not that way. He's not trying to get you. He is a giver. Not a taker. Anytime He takes anything out of your life, because He's a gentleman, he will discipline those He loves, and that's good. And I hope you like that. It'll happen anyway. He loves you. You should learn to like it and look forward to it. See, God has got, if you're born again tonight, you're in school. You may not be aware of it. You're in war. You can pretend it's not going on, and you will get
kicked from behind by the enemy. If you pretend that there is not a spiritual war going on, it's going on anyway, and you're involved in it. In fact, if you have not yet accepted Christ, then the war is really going on with you tonight, because the prize in this war is your soul. God wants to give you eternal life. He wants to forgive you of all your mistakes, and there's nobody here that hasn't made mistakes. Some Christians act like they've never been sinners, but the Word of God says that even though we may be Christians now, we are sinners saved by grace. We all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. In fact, some of us have really juicy testimonies. Boy, Christians love that. Oh, man, I was a sleazebag, man. Oh, boy, I was down in the dirt. But now I'm a good guy. I wear a white hat and I sell t-shirts. Some people think if you sing Christian music, well, obviously you're like Christ. That's not true. Hello? Testing. Yes, they're still there. There are people singing Christian music who don't live like Christ. There are people preaching in pulpits who don't live for God. There are people in bars who don't live for God, but they're not creating as much confusion. I think we owe it to Jesus if we believe He is the Son of God. And by the way, Satan believes that. He knows that's the truth, and he ain't going to be in heaven, so it takes more than that. Some people think, oh, yeah, you believe in God? Sure. It's obvious. I saw the sky. He's out there. Would you believe that Jesus is His Son? Oh, yeah. Well, if you believe that He will forgive you of your sins, do you want to continue to sin? What is the purpose of being forgiven if you're going to keep doing it? He never said, ask me to forgive you, tell me you're sorry, and then continue to do that and take it for granted that I will forgive you. And by the way, He will. I didn't come to bring you any condemnation around. God will forgive you 10,000 times, but you'll be the miserable sucker that has to live that life if you do that. If you know the truth will set you free. But wisdom is not knowing what is right. The Bible says wisdom is knowing what is right and doing it. And if you do what's right, you're going to be blessed. And what we need to check out tonight is, what are the blessings of God? Will they make us wimps? If we sell our lives out to Jesus, are we going to all be nerds? Bless God, man. He's good. Yeah. Now listen. David was a man after God's own heart. He wasn't an angel. But everybody who went to war with him found out he was a man after God's own heart. And he wasn't a perfect man. He sinned against God. He was a murderer. He committed murder. He committed adultery. Sounds like a man. A real person, you know. What is a real person? I mean, are we still real people, us Christians? Do we still have problems? I mean, because some people think he ain't supposed to have anymore. Well, if I accept Jesus, then He'll take away all temptation. He never said that in the Bible. It's not easy to be a Christian. It's hard, man. You got to work at it every day. You let down for one day, you're going to find out the enemy is still alive. Yes, there is a God, but there is also a Satan. God created him. Some people can't figure that. He was an angel. God created Lucifer. He was a created being, an angel. The Bible said God made him an angel of light. He was the head musician. I know some Christians probably think he had a rock band. Contemporary Christian group, right? But he rebelled and he was proud. God made him very beautiful and very wise, the Bible tells us. But he got proud because he was beautiful and because his music was good. And he was thrown out of heaven for that. And the Bible says that he convinced a third of the angels. Imagine, he must have been pretty slick. He must have been a good liar. He conned a third of the angels into believing that he was going to rebel against God and sit in the place of the Most High and take over the kingdom of God in heaven. And he was cast down to this planet, the Bible tells us. And he is roaming, he is patrolling this planet, seeking whom he may devour. Now, some people think, oh, he's trying to give me a headache. No, man, he's trying to kill you. As you grow older, young people, he wants to get you to marry somebody other than the one that God created for you. He wants you to marry somebody who seems like a real nice person, but who will not ever know the living God and follow him. Girls, he wants you to marry some other than a priest and a king. And that's what he's called us to be, guys. God Almighty's called us to be priests and kings. There's nothing boring about that. I've been all over this world, man. I've made millions of dollars. I've seen what it's got out there. I've never seen the excitement and the adventure of following Jesus. This is the most outrageous thing I've ever seen. Well, I never know what he's going to do. So God wants you to have a mate that will help you to get to heaven. Now, if you choose to choose your own, in a few years, when you're backstage at a counseling concert, I hope Jesus comes, but if he doesn't come by then, you're back there saying, oh, what am I going to do? My husband drinks a lot, and he's running with another woman, and he cusses at me, and he tells me everything's my fault. Will you pray for me? As if my prayers are going to straighten all that out. All I can do is take everybody here to the same book. If you obey it, if you believe it, it will. If you'll let it, he will come and settle in your heart. Faith comes from hearing and hearing the word of God. You can't know God any other way except by faith. Now, I have a gold American Express card, and if it would help any, if there was any other way to get faith, I'd buy us a ton of it tonight, and we'd just spread it around. We'd all go out here spiritual giants. But the only way to get it is by hearing the word of God. That means you got to read it, and that means you got to let people teach it to you. Well, every day I go in the room, every day people tell me their troubles. Every day I say, you've been reading your Bible? Well, I don't have time. I got all these problems. Well, it's the chicken before the egg, honey. If you don't read the Word of God and you don't let anybody teach it to you, then you are the Lord of your life. And you better be good. Nobody's ever made it yet. You can't save yourself. You can't take care. I mean, some of you get rich. Some of you can have a lot of money. I had a lot of money. And I didn't get fired from rock and roll either. I quit. I'm tired of doing interviews where people say, well, what happened? You know, what's the story? I met Jesus. And I determined that it was more important to follow him. I had known about him as a kid. When I was a teenager, I accepted Jesus as my Savior. You know the difference? He's not Savior. He is Lord. And I asked him to save me because it's like fire insurance, you know, in case there's a hell, I don't even go there. But I didn't want him to be Lord of my life because you know what Lord means? Lord means master. It means if he is my Lord, I ask him. I don't tell him what I'm going to do. I ask him, well, Father, I'm thinking about buying a car. Lord, I know you know a good car from a bad one. I know you know which one will be worth the most 3 years from now. You know what's going to happen to the Japanese economy or the American economy or the German economy. You know which one's going to be a good investment, and therefore I'm going to be a good steward if I do this. And I trust you. I know that you can give me. The Bible says that he gave Joseph honor. He gave him favor in Pharaoh's eyes. We've got a new bus out there. It's a It's a $370,000 bus. They gave us $151,000 off on it. Now, these German people have never, they never sold any of these in America. We got the first one. When we told them about 2 years ago, we wrote them a letter and said, you know, we believe you make the best coats in the world. We've been studying them. But we're Christians, and we don't have much money. We can't afford your coach. But we believe it's the best, and we belong to Jesus. And he takes care of his people and gives them the best. So we want you to think about it. We would like to drive the first one of your coaches in America. And if you can give us a lot off, we will. Now, these people laughed in German. Then about a year and a half later, they said, well, we're fixing to start importing into America, and we've determined that we would like for you to drive our demonstrator, not because you're Christians, but because you're family-oriented and you don't drink or smoke. We said, we'll take that, no problem. Yeah. See, they didn't even know that God touched their heart. The people over at Kenworth gave us a $112,000 truck, and they gave us $43,000 off. The trailer people gave us half price on a trailer. None of these companies have ever done this before. If you talk to the people that are not Christians there, they can't tell you why they did it. They tried to write me a letter and tell me, and they don't know. You go to buy a car, man, you need to pray about it. You don't have to. But God says, if any man lacks wisdom, let him ask. God will give you wisdom. He'll give you favor in people's eyes. What is it you want out of life? One day we were working on trains up in the sky, and we spent a lot of money on this video we were doing, right? And by the way, it's this week. VH1 is determining whether to play it or not. The colleges are picking it up. It looks good. We may get this one on MTV. Let me break it. MTV only played Stranger Danger a couple times. They said the words were offensive. They said Jesus is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Could we change the words? Are you kidding? So we were praying about this video. And then I was thinking about it, and I thought, man, two screens, right? I was laying in bed trying to go to sleep one night. And the Lord gave me this little thought. Over here is a video, and you're the producer and the director. Because that's what I get to do, right? I can think up whatever you're going to see. I get to just dream about it. It's far out. So you're the producer and the director, but this one is your life. This big, we used to do this when I'd open for the Stones and the Who. Sometimes the crowd would be so big you couldn't get them all in the building. They'd hire another PA and put these big screens outside. They're like 40 feet by 40 feet. This one over here, you're the producer. You get to marry who you want to. You get to live. Imagine what your house is going to look like. It's nice. Pool. Right? Drive what kind of car you want to. You get to marry the blonde guys. You get to have the kind of job you want. Everything you get to decide except the end in this one. And there's this other one over here, and the Lord God is the producer of this one now. If you get in this video, he's going to determine who you marry. You're going to have to talk to him and trust him and wait on him. Boy, isn't that waiting hard? Now, I know you girls are not dating anybody that's not born again, right? If you're, I know that there's people here determining tonight, well, what are these Christians, you know? You know, some girls pray and they want God to give them a husband, and then they date people who aren't born again, and they all say the same thing. Oh, I'm going to minister to him. He's going to get born again. A few years later, when they're divorced, they say, you know, why didn't God help me? God is telling you, man, if you're asking God for a husband, he doesn't have any that aren't born again. He can't give you one that's not born again, because that's the only ones he has. The rest of them refuse to trust him. And this one, he picks out your mate. And this one, you pray to him about where you live and what kind of job you have. What we have to determine tonight is, which one of these videos would you be the happiest in? Isn't that the bottom line? Is God trying to take us and put us in churchy religious jail? We're not anti-church, by the way. Man, you need to be involved with the church. We are against religion. We are against a form of godliness that denies the power of God. We're against that thought that says, well, if you wear a suit and tie, you'll be more holy. think about it. I would do it. If it would make me closer to God, I would wear a suit. I'd sleep in one. I read an article recently where one of these Christian people who are, think that criticism is one of the gifts of the Holy Spirit. And we had a guy tell, Paul, wasn't it last week? We were somewhere in Pennsylvania. Where were we?
Johnstown.
And a guy told Paul that if he didn't get a haircut, he was going to hell. But you could not go, put the lights on Paul's hair, please. Thank you.
You're looking mild.
Now this guy was hollering, me and Ben were walking down the street, right? Ben, where's Ben? Is he back there? Come out here, Ben. Are you close by? Me and Ben were walking down the street about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. We were going to get breakfast. Come up here, brother. Couldn't you find a pink shirt in here? Now, we did not have our arms around each other. We were just walking down the street. Just walk up. Ben has a little hair, you know, and we were walking down the street. So this guy crosses over the other side of the street, and he gets up the street. What did he holler?
I don't know. You're the one heard it.
Oh, well, he was hollering at us. We looked around. We didn't know he was hollering at us. So we turn around, and the guy's hollering, you need to get a haircut. You're going to hell. You need Jesus. And I looked around, and I thought, well, this guy's got to be talking. There wasn't anybody else on the street. I've got Jesus. I need more of Jesus. But I've got Jesus. The implication was the guy was real rude, wasn't he? Do you think it was really rude? You know, the Bible says that love is not rude. No, this is hard work. They think this is easy. The point is this, man. If there is something in our lives that needs to be changed, it's our hearts. The Bible says if we are going to be like Jesus, we must learn to think like He thinks. You know what the thoughts of God are called? Faith. When you think like God thinks, and by the way, this is how He thinks. The Word of God is the mind of God, the mind of Christ. The mind of the Holy Spirit, they think alike. When we are in unity with Him, as He is in unity with the Father, and we're in unity with each other, you can be transformed, it says. That's what change is. You can be transformed by the renewing of your mind in Christ Jesus. And that's the only way. So I just want to tell you, when you leave out of here tonight, if you will start spending time in God's Word and with Him every day, you will be a new creature. He will teach you how to believe. Some people say, well, I'm not sure I can believe that. Well, if you're willing to make an effort, He said, if you seek, you will find. Not you might find. You will find. If you knock, the door will be opened for you. There is no mystery anymore. I don't know anything that you can't know. Billy Graham doesn't know anything I can't know. You know, we are real people. If you stop and think about it, man, the President of the United States, Ronald Reagan, Princess Di, the Queen of England, they've all had diarrhea at one time or another. You know what I mean? We're just people. Some people think some people never have any problems, man. I wake up with bad breath. But some people have bad breath all day. You see, you can do something about it. Let's take that a step further. Let's be honest now. Let's tell the truth. There's some things that never get discussed. They're important. Do you think that Robert Shuler and Jerry Falwell and Jimmy Swaggart and Tammy Faye Baker have ever been horny? At one time or another, don't you think that they've ever been horny? said that, Mylon. Now, you're talking about nasty stuff. Listen, this is a real world. It's a real world. If you act like that there's no lust, what are we going to do next week? If there ain't no problems, then what do we need Jesus for? Those people, I'm not making fun of those people. Those people are my brothers and sisters, and they're my friends, and I love them. I'm not making fun of them. I'm telling you this, they are godly people, not because they've never been tempted to lust, because of what they did about it. They are godly people. You have to take authority over lust. It's a real thing. Just because they don't talk about it at church doesn't mean there isn't any. You have to do something about it. There is a spirit of lust. The Bible says there is pride of life. There's lust of the flesh. But you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. Some people say, oh, you can't live above lust. I'm telling you, in the name of Jesus, you can. And if you accept sin as a part of your lifestyle and just say, well, the Lord did some pretty good stuff in me and He'll forgive me for the rest, then what you're saying is, no, I don't want to be like Jesus. I don't want to be changed. I've been changed enough, thank you. I am now considered a Christian. I go to church. I pay tithes. I've been baptized. I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. I want to tell you, man, if you're going to get to heaven, you need to be in love. You need to enjoy the life of Christ, and it is enjoyable. The joy of the Lord is our strength, and without it, we're weak. The joy of the Lord means just simply that you're in love. See, God is love. You can't love somebody you don't know, so in order to get to know Jesus, you got to read His Word. There we are again. You got to have that faith. Do you believe that you can know Jesus just like you can know your wife, your kid, or your mom, your dad, your brothers and sisters? You can know Him better. He'll never let you down. So get to know Him. Once you get to know Him, you start expecting miracles. I don't know how to explain that. I can just tell you, there's one going on in my life right now. I went to the doctor a few weeks ago. The doctor said, oh man, you got this tumor growing in your back. It's about this big round. You got to cut it out. I said, well, how long will it take to get well? Couple weeks. I said, well, I got a tour next week. I can't do that now. I have to go, oh no, you can't do that. You don't understand. This could, most likely it's no big deal, but it could be dangerous and we got to get it out quick. It's growing now. It could grow really bad. It could grow really big. And I told the doctor, right, well, man, my life belongs to Jesus, so if I have a problem, it's His problem. He'll take care of me. He's calling me to do this. He'll take care of me. I was real bold, right, and I really felt like God will take care of this. I got home, my wife started questioning me about this. I started telling her, I got scared. I got to thinking about, oh man, what would happen if I wasn't around my wife and kids? Blah, blah. Who would sing in the band? How would they continue to preach? Blah, blah, blah. And I stayed right there. And man, I'll tell you, in the name of Jesus, when I'm gone, this band will be preaching. They will not just be making music. They are a good rock and roll band. I'm going to say that again. We don't even pretend to be a Christian, contemporary Christian group. We are a born-again, spirit-filled rock and roll band. That's the truth. God told us to tell the truth. The truth is such a thing. And so I went to the Lord, and the Word of God says, don't have any fear. When you accept Christ in your heart, He has not given me a spirit of fear, but power and love. Now, I could continue to have fear, or I can believe that. Because that's the bottom line, isn't it? If God's Word is true, then the Bible says that fear is an imagination, because I don't need to have any fear, because He didn't give me a spirit of fear. He gave me a spirit of power and love and a sound mind. Now, if the Word of God is true, I don't have any fear in me. If I let fear come on me, it's because I let it, but I don't have to. Christ has come to live in my heart. He had authority over all powers and principalities, the Word of God says. So I have it now. Do I take it or do I walk in fear? See how it is for you? It's simple. There isn't any mystery anymore. The mystery that once was God is now revealed in Christ. And you can know Him really, really good. You can know Him personally. You can know Him better than anybody. He is unchangeable. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. If you really trust Him, you'll go for it. It's radical, I know. I know it's radical. I want to encourage you to be radical, to be a peculiar people. to take over, to don't just be a wimp that's just pushed one way and then the other by the world. You belong to Jesus if you trust Him. It says that if you believe in your heart that He's the Son of God and that God has raised Him from the dead, and you confess it, and by the way, that's the problem for half of us tonight. The power of God. He said, don't be ashamed. Are you getting this? Do I need to stop and play a song so you'll hear this? Because this line here is so important. He said, don't be ashamed of the gospel, for it's the power of God unto salvation. He said, you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father in heaven. I was talking to my wife this afternoon. My kid's junior in high school, right? She goes to this school in Atlanta where it's sort of like in a wealthy neighborhood, but then there's lots of kids that get bussed in from the poor neighborhoods. So it's a really hectic school. They have a fine arts center there, and they have this, I don't know how to explain it, but the guy that's in charge of the liberal arts school, which I thought only colleges had, and I went to this high school when I was in high school, they didn't have anything like that then. Well, this guy is sort of, I don't know how to explain it any better than that. You know, he just, and so he encourages that in the kids, you know. And I went over there, and so he's got, they had a dress code when I was in school. Now the guys have like blue ponytails and, you know, mohawks, and there's bald-headed girls with things written in their skull, and this is kind of weird stuff. My little girl's in English class yesterday, and somebody, they were doing, they take turns doing these theses, you know, and they do an oral report on the report that they've turned in, and then the people in the class discuss it. One kid did one on premarital sex. Teenage pregnancies. And the conclusion that they came to, and they got discussing it, and the girl who did it said, well, if I grow up and I have a daughter, I'm going to tell her to take birth control, but if she gets pregnant, I'm going to tell her to have an abortion. I think that's the most intelligent way, rather than have her marry somebody she doesn't love. And so my little girl got up and said, well, you know, I'm a Christian. I don't believe in premarital sex. And I believe that abortion is a sin. And the teacher said at that point, if I understand it right, we don't want any religion in this class. And my daughter said, that's not religion, that's the Word of God. And so, I cried when my wife told me about it. My little girl came home a little bit upset. I say little, you know, she's 5 or 6, she's growing up. But she came home a little upset because she felt like she'd done the right thing, and she was sort of emotional about it, and yet some people had looked at her like, oh man. And what the Lord told me to remind her, I called her up after my wife told me that. She was at work. She works at a little drugstore on Saturday, the pharmacy, and I called her up and said, baby, I just want you to know I'm proud of you, I'm thankful for you, and I want to remind you that God said when you confess me before men, I confess you before my Father in heaven. You know, it's hard. You get made fun of. Some people, one guy that she was dating, quit dating her because she wouldn't go to bed with him. And then told some of the other guys, you know, don't waste your time with Summer because you won't get anywhere. And she told me, she said, you know, people don't believe that you can have love without having sex. Isn't that an amazing thing? I know some of you young people have been under pressure for a long time. Parents wouldn't believe how much pressure you get put under in school and in college and in high school. The places of work. Some parents have never believed how easy it is to get drugs here in this school. I saw the basketball team downstairs a while ago. Our dressing room is right next to theirs. They were having a game over here in the gym. It's the real world. And God is real. We have a real Savior. We have a real Lord. You can really live for Him. You can really enjoy Him. You can have abundant life in Christ. It's available to you. We're going to sing a little song of praise. We haven't done this song in this part of the country. We just started doing it last week. It's going to be released as a single after Christmas, and so we're just learning. But it is a song, and it's on a record, and we sell the record and all that. But when God gave us this song, it was just something to sing to Him because I love Him. And that's what it still is in my heart. So if you will let us, we're just going to worship God. And we would like to invite you to join in. The Bible says that He inhabits the praise of His people. He lives in the praise of His people. While we're singing this song, He's going to just live in it. He's going to come here and hang out with us. If you worship Him, He'll hang out in your praise. He'll come and inhabit your praise. This is Morning Star. He's my Morning Star.
I wanna be it's yours if you let it be. He is the lily of the valley. And there is a secret place that we can enter into with him, the word says. We can sit in heavenly places with the Most High God. Can we sing a song together? Come on, let's sing this. If you know the words, just enter in. He's the accepts it. You know, some people say, well, I don't know how to worship. As soon as you try, you're doing it. As soon as you try to worship God, you're doing it. And the more freely you worship him, of course, if you really trust him, you won't worry about what other people think. Do you know that that's what it means? When he says, I've come to set the captive spirit free, he's trying to deliver you from the evil ones trying to oppress you and depress you and get you hung up with guilt feelings and obsessed with all kinds of things other than just being free in Jesus. I want to invite you to just freely worship the Lord tonight. We're going to sing it again. We'll just make it personal. Let's sing it real gentle. Let's don't sing it for anybody that's around us. Let's just sing it. God can hear our hearts. Ago we were praying and the Lord told us to come out and encourage people to worship him freely because he loves them and he wants to do something for them. His people. His people are anybody who trusts him. If you're here tonight and you've never accepted the Lord, you know that the Spirit of God has been tugging at your heart tonight. He's revealed the truth to you about Jesus. You know Jesus is the Son of God. And the way you accept him is just by believing it and confessing it. I know it's hard. You're scared at first. Think you're going to lose some friends and that God wouldn't give you better ones? Or that he wouldn't do something for them too so that they could be even closer to you and better friends? And save them too. If you're here tonight and you need something from God, God touched my back. I was telling you about that earlier, man. I got ready to go on the tour. I got scared. The thing was still growing. It started to hurt. It was getting tighter and tighter. I couldn't move good. I went to church that last Sunday night. And Bible says over in James, it says, you know, if you, any among you sick, go to the elders and they'll anoint you with oil and pray in prayer of faith. You can be healed by the stripes of Jesus. Jesus let them put those stripes on his back. He let them beat him for our healing. And sure enough, you know, I was down there praying. I didn't notice any lightning flashing or thunder rolling, but I'll tell you, my back quit hurting and you know, and it's just that thing shrinking up. I don't know, you know, they may go looking for it next week. It may be gone. The point is, God has touched them. And when they do, if they have to go in there, it'll be benign and they'll just get it out. Because God wants to heal his people. Do you believe that? You believe? I mean, I know how I feel about my daughter, man. I know You know, she's not a little girl anymore. She's a woman. She's old enough to really get in trouble and mess up her life, and she's old enough to follow Jesus. And if I was at home telling her what to do, she's still going to do most of the time what she wants. I can't go to school with her. I can't follow her around on Friday and Saturday night. And I love her more than I can explain to anybody. And I would do anything for her. I wouldn't have any problem dying. If it came down to me or her and her mama, I'd give my life. God loves you so much more than I can possibly love her. He doesn't want you hurting. He doesn't want your heart broken. He doesn't want you lonely. Depressed. If you'll trust him, he wants to do something for you. You got an unsaved loved one you need to stand in intercession for? We're going to sing a song of worship. What the Lord told me to tell the people, and I've been telling them for a couple months, and I've seen him do miracle after miracle, is while we're singing this song, if you need something from God, you need healing in your mind, your emotions, your marriage, your relationship with your parents, your brother or sister, you need God to save somebody you love, you need something from God, I want to encourage you to take this little childlike step of faith while we sing this song. I want you to stand up and just sing it with us and just worship God and just don't worry about anybody around you. Orderly and gently, but just tenderly worship the Lord. And even as you trust Him enough to be more concerned about Him than the people around you, God's going to touch your heart. He's the only one that knows your needs. He's going to do a work for you. I tell you that in the name of Jesus. I expect miracles in this place right now as we sing. Oh, come let's
stand, you know what's going on in their lives, and I just ask you right now in the name of Jesus to touch them. I thank you, Lord, that you preordained this moment. I thank you that there is no accident. Who's here and who reached out to touch you said many are called, but few choose to meet the call. Few are chosen. Father, I just lift these people up to you in the name of Jesus and ask you to touch them. I ask you to set them free, to deliver them from any spirit of confusion or doubt or lust or pride or anything that's tried to hold them back. Satan, I tell you, have no power in their lives. And I command you to be gone from them. In Jesus' name, we bind you up. Father, we invite your Holy Spirit in this place. And we just thank you for your presence. We ask you for wisdom and for pure hearts and right motives. Proper intentions. We tell you again today that we love you and we trust you and we're thankful to be your children. Bless you, Father. I bless you in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. Well, let's praise God together. Some people don't believe that sky is going to break open, but the Bible says when Jesus returns, he's not coming back as a little baby in the manger. He's coming back with all the armies of heaven. And the Bible says if you're faithful and true, you're going to see him as he really is. It's going to be that high. You guys up here in Lancaster need to cheer up, son. You know why we praise God? Because He is the only one worthy to be praised, amen? I got some good news, and I got some good news, and I got some good news. There ain't no bad news here tonight. First of all, the concert is not over. Second, we're going to draw some of those cards you guys filled out and give away some things absolutely free. Third, after that, we're going to give you backsides. You can get them, walk around and talk to each other and go out in the lobby.
In order to serve God, you got to serve His people. Some of them are easier to love and some of them are really hard. But you don't love them because they're worth it or because they're worthy. You love them because God's Word says you're supposed to love one another. There's a lot of things in the Word of God I want to confess to you that I haven't learned how to do yet. And I'm just thankful that I'm not responsible. I've been told in the Word of God that He's the author and the finisher of my faith. And He that's begun a good work in me will finish it. Now, I don't know how to do this. I don't know how to be holy. The Word of God says He's coming again. He's coming back for a bride that's holy. Because He is. And that's the only church in His Word that He's coming back for. All these denominations, He didn't think that up. That was not Him. He gets the blame for it, but that was man. Word of God says He's coming back for the church. There's only one. All that competition and all that everybody saying everybody else is wrong. God said, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Work it out with Him, but work it out before Him. And remember that He is holy. I have no right to put down anybody anywhere. My responsibility to humble myself. I want to hear Him say, well done. Don't you want to hear that? I know there's a lot of people here who love the Lord now. Can anybody say amen?
Amen.
I know that that's an amen is one of those things that mostly just Christians say it. You know, I really believe that at the end of each concert, most of the people should be Christians. Not because we have some wonderful way of explaining Jesus, but because the Holy Spirit, the Word of God says that when you go and you try, that the Holy Spirit will put words in your mouth. And that He'll take them to the hearts of men as long as you stay with the Word of God. It is true. You believe that, don't you? Oh, I do too. And I'm betting my life on it. It's a safe one. There's something else in the Word of God, though, that I feel like the Lord would help me share with you tonight. And we didn't come here to preach at y'all and point our fingers. I can't help it sometimes. I'm trying to make these points, and they're so important to me. Because they're life or death. There was an old friend of mine that was one of the people that I truly loved. Before I met the Lord, there was this guy. His name was Alvin Lee. He was a guitar player. He had a band called 10 years After. We made a record together and we sold a few million copies and we trusted each other so much we even bought a lot of things together. We shared, we used to go to Jamaica every Christmas and take our gang down there. And it was about 115 degrees at Christmas time. They have these, they have this reef and there's these, the reef keeps all the bad guys out. You know, I don't want to swim with those sharks or barracuda or any of those things, you know. And so this reef keeps all the bad guys out. No, the none of fish that are bigger than you can get in there. Right? This is the way I like to swim. And so you can get these tanks, you can rent these tanks and you can go down to the bottom of this. It's only about 15, 18 feet deep. And there's all these corals and these bright gold. There's these fish that glow at night. You know, you can see them just like fluorescent. That's what they are. And there's these fish that you can see through.
transparent, translucent. I don't know what they are. They're trans-American. They're human. And there's these... And the sun is so bright because there's no man hadn't, industry hadn't messed up the air, right? So the sun is getting through the air to the ground, right? And the sand is so white, and it's got, you know, if you melt sand, it becomes glass, and a volcano or whatever put this island there, and like, it's glassy, like it's real shiny. And the water is so clean, nobody's dumping their sewer into the water there. It's what man does. So the water's clean, the sun gets through, it gets to this white sand that man hadn't messed up. It's amazing. You can see for hundreds of yards in just a regular old ocean. It is amazing to go around the world and see the places that God created when He created the earth that man hadn't messed up yet. Because, boy, this earth was incredible at one time. Go out in Colorado, up in the Rockies, and they got these helicopters. You can ride these helicopters back up in there, and they'll drop you off on top of a mountain. And there's no industry or anything. There's no roads back there. You have to ski out of there. You know, they drop you off, there's like billions of snowflakes. Billions upon billions. And not even one of them is like any of the others. Isn't it amazing some of the stuff God does? And yet some people think that heaven's going to be boring. He's gone away to prepare a place for us. He's been working on it for 2,000 years. And He made all this in 6 days. Boy, I don't know. I think heaven's going to be incredible. Bible says that man, eyes not seen, ears not heard, neither is the mind of man even imagined what paradise is going to be like. Not going to be any sin, so there's not going to be any wages of sin, sickness, death. Not going to be any thieves, no murderers, no. Except the ones that get born again, they're not going to be thieves and murderers anymore. The Bible says there's not going to be any temptation to sin. Boy, think about that. But there's something else in the Word of God that I want to share with you tonight. So you need to think about this. There are people who are going to stand before Jesus. He said this on that last day, and they're going to say, "Lord, Lord." Now listen, that's not the Moonies and Krishna people with the little, you know, little ponytails and the ding ding things. These are Christians. Because those people don't call Jesus Lord. They're going to say, "Lord, Lord, look at all the stuff we did in your name." Some of them are going to say, "We laid hands on the sick, and they were healed in your name." Some of those people are going to say, "We cast out demons in your name." And you know, those are really religious people. Those people who don't go to church a lot wouldn't even know about that. Think about that. And He said, "I'm going to have to say to some of those people, depart from me, you workers of iniquity. I never knew you. You never knew me. You knew about me, but you never took the time to get to know me, and therefore you went around and misrepresented me." We who believe in, well, most of us are Christians here now and have been for a long time, isn't that the truth? And yet most of us, I just want to say this to you. When you tell somebody you're a Christian, you're saying to them, "Look at me, watch my life, you're going to see the power of God. Because God has power, and His power will flow through anybody who draws close to Him. It's not limited by our ability to comprehend it. It's real. It's true." And that's enough said. The gospel has been preached to you tonight. He said, "Go into all the world and teach and preach and make disciples." Kenny, come out here for a minute, please, sir. I want you to share something from me. Kenny told me some... There's three things to the Lordship of Christ that we all need. There's three things that we need in our life every day if we're going to have the total Lordship of Jesus Christ. And those things are prayer and reading God's Word. Of course, that people teach it to us. And the third thing is that we need to determine whether God is more important to us or people. So in other words, we need to determine who we should hang out with. And Kenny shared some scriptures with me that are so good, I wanted to share with you so that you know that these are not ideas. This is exactly what God has to say about it.
Amen. To grow, to be what God would have you to be, and it's not a mystical affair, it's very practical, but you need to take some steps upon yourselves to become that person in Christ. And Mylon mentioned prayer. And why would God mention prayer? Because Jesus said in Matthew 26:41, to keep watching and to keep praying that you enter not into temptation. For the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. So I don't have to ask for the show of hands or how many people can raise their hand to show that they're blown. I don't have to ask for that. Because I'm sure at least one time or another, we all have blown it. And most of us can relate it back to because we were not spending that time with God in prayer. And that's why you can't pretend to do this by yourself and say, oh yes, I've read the four Gospels and now I know how Jesus was, so I'm going to go around and say, I love you, brother. And that doesn't do it. That doesn't do it. But the next thing that the Lord showed us was that you have to read His Word. And His Word is so alive. Man, it is more alive than the air you breathe and then the blood cell that runs through your veins. It is. Because He said heaven and earth will pass away, but my word won't. Because the Word of God is inspired by God. And it is so inspired that it is profitable for correction, for reproof, for training, for teaching in righteousness. Yeah. So you apply it, guess what happens? It begins to change you, man. You can't be the same sitting under the tent of Jesus. You can have religion, but when you meet Jesus, I mean, damn, when you meet the Lord, you don't come back the same. You either become one of His or enemy of His. That's why when the Pharisees sent the soldiers out to trap Jesus and to bind Him up and bring Him, and they came back and they said, well, where is this Jesus we told you to get? And you know what they told them? Never a man spoke like Him, because He spoke truth. Amen. And what happened? We began to become transformed from this particular man who spent 3 years of his life training 12 people. And then they began to share with their family and friends. And guess what happened? They had fellowship. And that's why David can say how good and pleasant it is for brothers to dwell in unity. Yes, yes. Let me tell you, real quickly before I go, I can't do it by myself. It seems that we have it all together because we have all the answers right now for what we have presented. But we have to go to God in prayer every day. We have to study His Word every day. And we have to keep ourselves in a close-knit family type manner. Because without each other, we cannot make it. That's why you hear, if you've ever heard of someone who's been a Christian, but yet they were hanging around, you know, the affairs of, let's say the affairs of the world, or people who were not really digging the Lord, to put it so bluntly. I've heard of many cases where people have fallen back into the things that they once come from. And you don't have to be that way tonight. We're going to offer everybody here who needs this particular opportunity a chance to get it right with God. I'm going to offer you the chance not only to get saved, but to recommit your life. Because God loves you. He cares. He sent His only begotten Son that you should have eternal life, that you shouldn't perish. So if you perish, it's because you choose. And God said, my will is not that any man should perish, but all shall come into the knowledge of the truth. We have a room back here. You go down this hall and through some double doors down there. We're in the cafeteria. We're going to have counselors there. And they're waiting to help you to know Jesus. Amen. Thank you.
It's good preaching, Ken.
We're brothers. I know we don't look a lot alike, but we definitely are. This is the Gospel of John. It's one of the books of the Bible. And if you came here tonight and you just accepted Christ in your heart, I want to give you one of these. I want you to start reading the Bible tonight. And boy, it'll thrill your heart. It's not a book. I mean, it looks like a magazine. Listen, this is the Word of God. You let it in your mind, it'll change your mind. It doesn't ever come back void. We had this little track printed up, and it just says, if it didn't sound like good news, you ain't really heard the gospel. It explains what the gospel is. This is good news, y'all. This has got our address back there in case we can do anything to help you. I want to read something to you real quick. I know we've done a lot of preaching tonight. You people that come to see us and bring your friends, you already knew that when you got here. You knew we don't just play music. So I ain't going to apologize at all. Luke 8. We got four categories, and we need to determine tonight which one we... I wish I could get closer than this to you. I wish I could just... If you ever wanted to just go and just do a swan dive and land in a bunch of people and hug everybody, that'd be great, wouldn't it? This is... There are four categories that our hearts fall into, all of us. Everybody you know and everybody here tonight. I'm going to make this quick, but you need to know this. I believe the Lord told me to tell you this. This is, the Word of God is seed. And God gave a little parable. The Lord Jesus gave a parable. And this is its explanation. This is its meaning. The seed is God's message to man. The hard path, that's the first category. Now, the parable he gave was about putting a farmer throws some seed out. And the seed lands in four different kinds of soil. And of course, the soil is our hearts. And so I want you to determine tonight which kind of heart you have. The seed is God's message to man. The hard path, where some seed fell, represents the hard hearts of those who hear the words of God. But then the devil comes and steals the words away. That's what it means when it says he's the thief. He comes to steal. He's trying to steal all your blessings. He's trying to steal your eternal life. Steal the Word of God out of your heart. The hard hearts of those who hear the Word of God, but then the devil comes and steals the Word away and prevents the people from believing and being saved. That's category number one. I pray in the name of Jesus, nobody here falls in that category tonight. The second category, the stony realm, represents those who enjoy listening to sermons. They enjoy it. But somehow the message never really gets through to them. And it doesn't take root and grow. That's why you got to get in the Word to grow. They know that the message is true, and they sort of believe it for a while until the hot winds of persecution come. And then they lose interest. The seed among the thorns, category three. The seed among the thorns. And this is where a lot of Christians fall. I pray that no one is in this category. The seed among the thorns represents those who listen and believe God's word. They believe it. But whose faith afterwards is choked out by worry, the desire for riches and the pursuit thereof, the responsibilities and the pleasures of life. And so they're never able to help anyone else to believe the good news. Category four. But the good soul represents honest, good-hearted people. They listen to God's words, and listen to this now. They cling to them, and they steadily spread them so that others also soon believe. That's how we get washed in the Word of God. When Jesus came to the earth, it was to teach us how to be priests. A priest washes his people, his family. Jesus did it with his bride. The church washes his bride in the Word. And in that washing, Kenny's my roommate. Me and Kenny room together on the road. There's 12 of us out here, you know, because we got a lot. There's tons of equipment we had to set up every day. There's a lot of people.